Hi, everybody. This is Lisa.
And this is Joe.
And welcome to your cheap date for August 19th, 2006.
That's Cheap Date, the show that asks the question.
How much oil should I use in the hot air popcorn popper?
Brilliant.
Huh? A tablespoon? Two tablespoons?
Half a cup.
Half a cup?
But wait until...
It says half a cup max.
Yes, wait until... Oh, God. Wait until you've had it running for about a good 2-3 minutes. So it gets good and hot. Then dump the quarter cup of oil in there.
Hey, you know what? Not everybody is a popcorn genius like you.
Oh, gosh.
I knew to use the peanut oil. I knew to not cut open the bag of microwave popcorn, but to use the stuff in the jar.
Yeah.
I knew to put butter and salt on it.
Yeah.
Actually, it's funny. When I first popped it, I only put in like a tablespoon of kernels because I had no idea how much it would make.
It gives you like a...
And I got like a handful of popcorn. Emma was like... What's wrong?
Just a little bit. And had you used oil in the place, we wouldn't be sitting here recording a show right now because the fire department would be here.
Hey, you know, you say that like the fire department is this band of maniacs that you would hate to be here.
Well,
there
I have a two-part answer to that. A.
The last time the fire department was here, dot, dot, dot.
And the fact that you're on a first name basis with them. No.
A. I do know where my fire extinguisher is, and I know how to use it.
That's good. It's too bad we don't have one here.
I also know what to do if there's not a fire extinguisher. Well, I'm not sure if it would work with a hot air popcorn fire. But last time I had a kitchen fire... Because I didn't want to make a mess with the fire extinguisher, I soaked towels in the bathtub and threw them on the fire.
Oh, okay. Well, those also... Okay.
Which would work maybe after I unplugged the popcorn.
Yeah, because otherwise it would blow everywhere. Yes, unplug.
Which assumes that the fire is not so... Now, the last time it was on the stove, and the fire was not so great that I couldn't reach over the stove to turn off the heat.
Was this fire in the state of Illinois?
No, okay. You know perfectly well it wasn't.
Okay, I'm just asking. Regarding the fire department, A, if people go back and listen to our podcast about the Chef's Fest, they will know that
fire department... we love the fire department.
We had a fire department official swearing on our
podcast. Come on, don't be a little old lady about it.
Oh, gee. I mean... Oh, what are they saying that for? Remember that skit on Saturday Night Live? She became her mother.
Julia.
Oh, why do they go have to do that?
Oh, yeah, this is a really good movie. Oh, now, why do they have to show that?
She became her mother.
Are you becoming your mother? No, your mother's cool. You're becoming...
I'm just becoming.
Somebody.
I'm quite becoming.
Okay. And B...
Tonight's episode of Cheap Date is fueled by 312 Urban Eat Whale. Yeah, oh, here. We got to do it again. There.
Smashing bottles.
Courtesy of the Goose Island. Well, it's not courtesy of. We paid for it. From the Goose Island Brewing Company of Chicago, Illinois.
Did you say Urban Eat Whale?
Urban.
You did.
That's a new band. Urban Eat Whale. Did I really say that? Okay, well.
Yeah, you're cut off, pal.
Urban Wheat Ale.
Is it an historic or a historic?
Oh, no, let's not start that.
Okay. And B.
I forgot what B was. We're already on to something else. Don't worry about it. It's long gone. So anyway, we had a fun week this past week, in addition to an awesome cheap date, which we found.
I'm not really a big popcorn fan. That's why I don't know how to make it. I just want to tell
her. But you grew up in Indiana.
So
Orville Redenbacher.
I just want to very quickly clarify for the readers or our listeners that it's not that I am an idiot and don't know how to run kitchen machinery. It's just that popcorn in particular, I never, ever, ever make or eat.
Right.
So I don't know.
That's one of the awesome things about going to see a movie with you is that I can get the giant tub and and I can just dive right in.
I don't even touch it. Like, I touch it, but I've never known anyone as uninterested in popcorn as me.
Wow. See, like, I love popcorn. And I think, as popcorn aficionados go, I think I'm in the minority, because most people who really, really like popcorn seem to like white popcorn. And mm-hmm. I am a huge fan of the yellow popcorn. Bigger, fluffy kernels. That's what I want. Got the Orville Redenbacher thing. And you know, whenever we go down to Indiana, when you're heading down I-65, you go by that huge crib.
Uh-huh.
Yo, my crib. It's my popcorn crib, yo.
No, I immediately think of a corn crib when you say crib.
See? That's actually an interesting thing for some of our listeners. And when I use the word crib, what does that make you think of? But we're going down and we saw that it's a huge, a silo, whatever you would call it.
Okay, yes.
That has the name of the popcorn company on the side of it. You know what I'm talking about? It's right before you start heading into, it's real close to Indianapolis.
I'm sure I know, but.
That's right. But, and I always think, man, I should look those people up and see if their popcorn's any better than Orville. I think Orville's good, but for me, Jolly Time does the trick.
I would like to see a smaller percentage of the kernels unpopped.
I think that's what Orville spent most of his life. That was the problem that I think Orville Redenbacher drove himself insane trying to solve that problem.
Based on tonight, I'm not impressed.
Well,
but then there may have been operator error.
You did it in the hot air popper. Could have done it on the stove with the peanut
oil.
Oh,
if I did it on the stove, would I get a higher? You know what? I was almost going to do it on the stove because there were actually instructions on the jar.
On the jar?
On the jar. Okay. I'm not sure if it's a jar. The top is narrow like a bottle. I wanted to say bottle.
It's a squat plastic bottle.
Everybody knows what popcorn comes in, Joe.
Well, yeah. When I was
don't insult our listeners. Bags.
Did I mention that was the name of one of my bands? The Squat Plastic Bottles?
Don't insult our listeners. Was the name of one of your bands? Yeah. How many bands have you been in?
I've been in many, many, many albums. Many bands. We've had many albums.
Joe informed me right before the show that he is both an Antichrist and an Anarchist.
That's right. I want to be Anarchy.
I don't think you can be Anarchy. Ask
freaking Johnny Rotten.
That's
okay?
Like wanting to be religion.
Well,
what?
Ask freaking Johnny Rotten. I don't know.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so we talked about popcorns, and I started mentioning movies. We saw a movie this weekend.
Yeah, what movie?
We saw Kevin Smith's latest piece of work. I didn't mean that to sound derisive. Clerks 2.
Yeah, what'd you think?
I thought it was very good. Now, Lisa,
were you expecting to like it?
Actually, my expectations were very low, and I'll tell you why.
As were mine.
I liked Clerks. I think the best movie that Kevin Smith made was Dogma.
Agreed.
But Dogma was high budget. It had a very intricate plot. It had a very high, not in the sarcastic sense, it had a very high concept.
I mean,
there was a lot. And you really had to be a Catholic to understand 90% of the movie.
Actually, it was an interesting movie because it went all the way from stupid J jokes up to the very highest, most nuanced, if I can say that, comedy there is.
Yeah. So,
and I'm not sure everybody got the full range of it.
Right. So there's that. I never saw Jersey Girl. I did see the first.
Nobody did.
I did see the first Clerks. And I thought the first Clerks was good, but I was under the impression that the reason it was really good was because it was low budget, black and white, just a bunch of guys screwing around making a movie.
Mm-hmm.
So I walked into this movie thinking, okay, I'm going to give it a chance, but we'll see what happens. And I was very pleasantly surprised. I thought he handled it very well.
I was too. I was a little bit nervous about seeing Dante and Randall in color.
Mm-hmm.
And seeing the Quick Stop in color. I mean,
yes, and actually in vivid colors at one point, but we're not going to ruin the movie for people.
And I was nervous about it because I thought he took a great movie, Clerks, and took it as low as it could possibly go in Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back.
Yes, actually that was my other part, is he followed up. Did he do Dogma right after? Did he do Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back right after he did Dogma?
As far as I know, it went Clerks, Mallrats, Chasing Amy, Dogma, Jay and Silent Bob, Jersey Girl, Clerks 2.
Okay. Yeah, because Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back, to me, and it was intended to be this way. It was a string of inside jokes. You had to have seen all of the other Kevin Smith movies up to that point.
Inside jokes.
Exactly. So, but anyway, back to Clerks 2.
There were some inside jokes in Clerks 2. I mean, you wouldn't want to go into it never having seen Clerks.
One of the actors that Kevin Smith likes to use very often, who has since made it very big, appears in this movie.
Who?
People are going to have to go see it. Okay, Affleck appears in the movie.
Oh, sure. I thought you meant Jason Lee.
Actually, Jason Lee's doing pretty well for himself as well.
Yeah, he is.
Yeah. So anyway, I was very pleasantly surprised. I thought he handled the characters well. He handled the transition of these characters, and there was you saw other sides, other dimensions to these people that you didn't see the first time around.
And quite frankly, I think he finally put this damn thing to bed.
Yes. There will
and
not be a Clerks 3.
None too soon.
And I don't think we're going to be seeing any more of Jay and Silent Bob for a while.
I would be fine with that.
Yeah. What are you talking about?
Joe, party of two, your table is ready.
Well.
Here we are.
Here we are at a true cheap date. And this was really a spur of the moment cheap date for us, wasn't it?
Introduce it, and then I have to tell you something.
We went to Finn McCool's Irish Pub in Schaumburg, Illinois. That's where we went.
On a Tuesday night?
I believe it was a...
Just out of the blue.
Out of the blue. You had a rough day at work and you just needed to get out and get some food?
Every day at work has been rough this week. But yeah, it wouldn't have been Tuesday because we had the kids Tuesday. It must have been Monday.
It was Monday night.
I did work late Monday.
Oh, that's what it was.
And I took no lunch on Monday.
That's what it was.
Not to gripe about that.
Okay, but anyway.
I have to make a confession. Joe went to the gym after work on Monday, and I came over to Joe's place to hang out and wait for him to get back. And on your way back from the gym, you called, and we were talking about dinner options because I had gotten out of work too late to cook anything as I had intended. And
I went straight to the gym so I couldn't cook anything for you. Let it be known that I have cooked dinner for you. I don't want it to make it seem
many a
like...
time. And we're not talking grilled cheese.
Thank you.
But no, I had intended to make dinner for both of us, and our plans were thwarted. And you called on the way back from the gym.
I don't think I've ever heard you use the word thwarted before. My plans were thwarted. Make it so.
Every day another layer is peeled away.
I'm just going to sit here and look at you dreamily while you continue your story. Go ahead.
You called on the way home on the way home from the gym and suggested Applebee's. And Lord
those
knows.
Those are little red cartoon hearts popping around my head.
Okay, you know what? Go back to just looking dreamily and quietly. You suggested Applebee's, and Lord knows I am a sucker for Applebee's. So I was all excited about that. And then when you got home, you suggested Finn McCool's. I have to be honest, I wanted Applebee's.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, but I was thinking, there's a happy ending to this. I was thinking, I want to go somewhere where I know for sure that I'm going to like what I have. I had been drooling over my Fiesta Lime chicken for 20 minutes. I was all psyched up for it. And then you said Finn McCool's, and I didn't know what was on the menu. I didn't know if it was going to be good. But I decided to go with it. And I'm very glad we did.
You were delighted.
I was delighted. I just wanted you to know that I was going into it a little bit apprehensive.
Now, I'll tell you my apprehension with this place. They opened it earlier this year. Now, first of all, it's called Finn McCool's. When you do a Google search on Finn McCool, you will find probably 100 restaurants in the United States called Finn McCool. Finn McCool is actually an ancient, he's a mythological Celtic hero. And leader of the Finians.
Duh.
There you go. He was leader of the Finians. I think he was lead singer and lead guitar.
Was that one of your bands, too?
No, I wasn't in the Finians.
What are you, Phil Spector?
No, I'm looking
that would explain a lot.
Anyway, this place opened up, and the first thing that worried me was the fact that the spot that it's located in has been about, in the last 20 years, it's probably been maybe 7 or 8 different restaurants, mm-hmm. none of which were successful except for its initial incarnation, which was like a Greek diner family style restaurant kind of place.
Mm-hmm.
when they change it over to this thing, their logo is kind of a wacky green and yellow, bright yellow, sort of mall-looking kind of logo.
Mall Irish.
You know what I'm talking about? You know what I'm talking about? I mean, Bennigan's has a cooler logo than Finn McCool's does. I'll tell you that. Wouldn't you say? I mean, Bennigan's at least is like...
I'm not really familiar with the logos, but I would say it looks no more authentic than Bennigan's.
Exactly. So we went in there, and but you know what? I figured, hey, let's try it. It's actually a pub. Now, the other thing I want to mention is that it's billed as an Irish pub. It's not billed as a restaurant.
And that's accurate.
And that's an accurate thing because there's one key thing that if our listeners have one particular thing that they're looking for in a restaurant or looking for to a restaurant to not have, you will not find it here.
Why?
And that is, it's a pub, so it is not a no-smoking restaurant.
There is no smoking area.
Right. People were smoking in here. It's a pub. It's a bar in the center with tables all the way around it.
Mm-hmm.
So if you are very sensitive to cigarette smoke, just be aware of the fact that there will be people nearby smoking.
They do let kids in.
They do. And they have lots of TVs up there.
Or at least maybe they stop at a certain hour. I don't know.
Yeah. But they have TVs all over the place. I think they have DJs there on the weekends. On the wall, they have album covers basically from my record collection of the 80s up there.
Oh, boy.
We were sitting right next to a copy of Elvis Costello's Get Happy and Aerosmith's Draw the Line.
Uh-huh.
And there was one other.
Some other band that I had never heard of before.
Yeah?
I can envision the cover. There's a bunch of guys lined up.
Oh, Madness. Madness, One Step Beyond.
There you go.
See, all stuff from my past. Most of our younger listeners won't remember any of these bands, but
no, nor do I.
Anyway, Lisa, tell us why this was truly a cheap date.
I'll tell you why. Daily specials.
Two of the sweetest words in the English or any other language.
Listen to this. We got in there at 7:30, so we missed the half-price appetizers. Fine, because I wasn't actually all that hungry. What we did not miss were $3 20-ounce domestic drafts.
Oh, yeah. MGD for me.
Miller Lite for me.
And as I sat there drinking my beer, I
Joe
am not too
pounded
proud.
Pounded his fist on the table like he'd had four of them and declared that he is not too good. Sometimes this is all you need.
That's right. It was a hot summer evening.
That's how I feel about Budweiser.
Yeah. It's you know what? As Lisa has said in previous episodes, I like beer.
Oh, now don't start that again. I've never heard the end of that.
No, anyway, so I had MGD, and I am not too proud to admit that occasionally, especially when it's cheap,
yeah.
I enjoy an MGD.
So, the $3 beers and the $4 burger.
There you go. That's all you need to know.
Needless to say, which is $4. A burger, what do you think? A quarter pound? A third pound?
Probably a quarter pound. Between a quarter and a third. Yeah, I'd say a quarter pound.
It was a big quarter pound.
It was. Yeah.
Quarter pound, all the standard burger stuff and fries, $4.
Right.
Are you kidding me?
Can't pass it up.
We each got...
Thin cut fries, right? Or were they crinkle cut fries?
They were crinkle cut.
Crinkle cut fries, that's right.
We each got perfectly
cooked.
A burger and a beer for $7 mm-hmm. each. I was impressed.
A very
also,
fresh bun, I might add. Gotta make sure your buns are...
Okay.
We have friends up in Minneapolis who know all about fresh buns.
Hey.
Sorry. Go ahead.
They have great specials every other day. What did I want to mention? Oh, the table tapper.
Oh, yes.
We saw some guys who had this thing. It's a... how to describe this? It's a clear cylinder about 3 feet tall
with a
tap at the bottom.
It looks like one of those yard... You thought it was one of those yard longs on the table.
Yes, because I was talking to somebody about yard longs just recently, and she said, well, I've been to places where you can get a yard long with a tap at the bottom. And I was thinking of just the yard long glasses that you, I guess, drink from.
Right.
But yeah, it was about a yard long, only thicker. It's actually... it's like... What did our waitress say? 9... glasses of beer. It's pretty
good. Oh,
exciting.
Yeah.
Anyway, you would think with, or I would think with prices like these, that you would be in a rundown shack of a place. But that's not the case with Fimacools.
It's true. It's brand new.
It's brand new. It's authentic enough for my taste, for whatever that's worth.
It's, you know what? It's as Irish as Benny. Well, I will say that the manager came over and introduced himself, a really nice guy, and from Ireland. And yeah. he took a genuine interest. He's like, oh, first time here, and he you know, hung out at the table with us, and we talked for a while. So, but that was cool. So he kind of made us feel at home.
And I liked the way they had the tables arranged. I liked the way they had the TVs set up. It's someplace I would definitely go and hang out for a few hours and drink a few beers.
We're gonna try this place when the football season starts.
Yes, it's gonna be great.
I'm not a huge football fan, but you know what? This is the kind of place to go watch it. Here's an interesting thing about Finn's. They also have on the daily specials. Every day they have something else. On Sunday, they have a homemade chicken dinner.
Oh, man.
They have drink specials every day, which I am not going to go into. Tuesdays, $5.99 shepherd's pie. Wednesdays, $5.99 corned beef and cabbage. Pot roasted vegetables on Thursday. Lake Perch fish fry on Fridays. And $9.99 New York prime strip steak on Saturdays. And they have a DJ who rocks the house. Hey, gonna rock the house from 8 p.m. to 3 a.m. Yeah.
It doesn't seem like a place that would have dancing, but maybe.
Yeah. So anyway, and the other interesting thing we learned about Finn McCool's is that they are owned and run by a place called A La Carte, which is a chain here in Chicago who runs a bunch of different restaurants, including Magnum Steakhouse, Pizzazz Kitchen, Chandler's Chop House, Moretti's in Edison Park, and there's also a Moretti's right next door that used to be at a TGA Fridays. It's right next door to Finn McCool's. Mm-hmm. Metro Deli and Cafe, Famous Freddy's Roadhouse, the Alumni Club, the Snuggery. They own a whole bunch of places that you would be familiar with if you're around Chicago. The Apartment, Vision, Excalibur, Lion's Head Pub, Celtic Crown Irish Pub, Deja Vu in Lincoln Park. So they own, you know, a lot of places. And we also learned as well that one of my favorite place in Chicago for a martini, which is now gone, mm-hmm. was Basta, or Basta Pasta, located in Edison Park, which closed several months ago.
Mm-hmm.
This company is going to be reopening the 70s steakhouse, that Steak Joynt.
With a Y.
With a Y. You figure out where the Y goes. They're going to be opening
preferably
a restaurant.
Have two beers and then try to figure out where the Y goes.
Say, they are going to open that Steak Joynt in the location where Basta is now vacant.
Right.
So if you go through downtown Edison Park, and if you take the train, take the Northwest Line train into Chicago from the suburbs, you actually go by this every day. You see the big, giant spaghetti bowl hanging off the side of the building and a vacant restaurant underneath it.
Yes.
But I will say that Basta had the best margaritas. The best martinis. They had the best martinis
anywhere. Yeah,
anywhere.
They had a great list. I remember we went there that night and that guy was playing Sinatra tunes on the piano.
Yeah, that's right.
It was so loungy.
It was truly loungy. It was loungy without being kitschy.
That's right. It was loungy but not tacky. One thing we have not covered is the tiny little charge on our bill for dessert.
Oh, that's right. We forgot.
It was Joe's idea to order
the fried Twinkie, which Jennifer, our waitress, said was her absolute favorite thing on the menu.
She was kind of, it was funny because she was kind of like skittish to ask us if we liked it.
She comes in and goes, did you like it?
Because I guess nobody else is really crazy about it, but she loves it.
Yeah.
Actually, she said the deep fried, or the cheesecake chimichangas are even better.
Cheesecake chimichangas, ladies and gentlemen.
But a deep fried Twinkie, yeah, it was breaded in, I think, like crushed cornflakes.
I think it was rolled in crushed cornflakes and then fried.
And then fried.
I've never had, at a county fair or anything, I've never had a deep fried Twinkie before. It was my first experience with it, and it was actually pretty good. The one thing that I noticed, and I explained to Jennifer, this was not a complaint, mm-hmm. was the fact that the creamy filling, and I'm using air quotes here, the creamy filling
that scientists can't explain.
Yes, go to the Twinkies Project for all the details on that. Link in the show notes. The creamy filling was rendered completely flavorless by the frying process.
It was like creamy white
nothing.
Hair.
It was texture. It wasn't even texture.
Not even.
Even marshmallow fluff, or like if you do what I do and you take Peeps and you stick them on a bamboo skewer and you toast them over the range.
Over the open gas range. Don't even get me started.
Ooh, and you know what?
The trashiest thing I've ever seen.
The stores are starting to get the Halloween Peeps now too. You get the spooky cats and the Halloween pumpkins.
Don't even go.
Black sugar all over my stove.
You worry about me getting the fire department in here.
And yes, ladies and gentlemen, I am an adult. And I'm a taxpayer. And I'm a productive member of society.
The fire department is there for you.
So
you
anyway.
You pay taxes so you can roast marshmallows on your stove. Anyway.
Now, with this festival of food that we just described to you, our bill, ladies and gentlemen, without tip, was $18.
Yeah, that's nice.
You can't beat that. That was truly a cheap date. It was one of those times when we sat there and I actually felt guilty about not ordering more.
So, Joe, I live in the greater Chicagoland area.
God, smack you.
Where can I find Finn McCool's?
You can find Finn McCool's at 1941 East Algonquin Road in Schaumburg, Illinois. All right, Sweet Pea, we're going to have to wrap this one up. We're running late.
That is more than enough out of us. Oh, wait a minute. This 312 says serve in a tall glass.
Oops.
We've been drinking it wrong.
See, that's what you get for drinking it right out of the bottle.
All right.
Yeah. We want to thank everybody for all the comments and notes. And don't forget, if you want a guest, submit a guest review for us to read on the air, or if you'd like to...
do a call to the table.
That's right.
We'd love that. It can be 2 seconds long, or it can be something a little bit more personalized
and creative.
Whatever floats your boat. We love your sweet little voices, and we would love to feature them on our show.
And how can they get a hold of us, darling?
They should probably email dish@cheapdateshow.com.
Or
they can come to our website, which is cheapdateshow.com. See how that works? You only have
to remember
one thing.
So it's like the same one. Oh, wow. Do I have to put the http://? That in front of it?
If you do, it's time for a new computer.
Gotcha. Time to upgrade.
Yes.
Okay.
And you're probably not listening to a podcast.
Yeah, you're anyhow, probably playing some sort of text game on there. You're playing Mystery House or something like that on your Apple II.
They can come to cheapdateshow.com, follow links to the places we mention, and comment for all to read and enjoy.
Yeah. So thanks again for listening, everybody. We will talk to you next week.
Good night.
This podcast is proudly listed at podcastpickle.com.
This is all good material that we're missing out on now.
Oh, I'm... You know what?
No, it's okay. That's okay. And...
Hi, everybody. This is Lisa.
This is Joe.
And welcome to your cheap date for August...
Oh, here we go again.
19?
19.
No, today's 17,
18, 19. Take two.
Sorry.